Good afternoon, everyone. It looks like the wind has blown in a little hope today. I'm glad to bring you people who have a message for us about a struggle that we are very much a part of, even though we're not always aware of it. And it's a struggle that's had remarkable success. We're lucky to have with us today three speakers who are going to talk about agricultural change in very different parts of the world, but agricultural change is ultimately very much the same. We'd like to ask you to welcome first Rose Edith Germain from the MNNKP in Haiti. Flavio Barbosa from the Landless Workers Movement in Brazil, the MST, and he's a part of the Brigade de Solidaridade Jean-Jacques Dessalines, which is a group from Brazil that's working in solidarity in Haiti. And at the end of the table, looking very much like the person from Maine, Bob St. Peter with Family Farm Defenders. So what is it that brings together Maine, Haiti, and Brazil? It's Via Campesina. Via Campesina, as many of us know, is an international organization of peasant struggle, and that has been able to tie together people who are working for sustainable agriculture from Costa Rica to Sri Lanka, and Chicago is a part of that process as well. I think many of us know this is the center of global agricultural pricing, and so it's especially appropriate that in the city of the Board of Trade, we can hear different voices. I want to point out that Via Campesina is an extraordinarily powerful organization, and we're going to be able to hear today about how Via Campesina was able to defeat Monsanto in Haiti and to turn back a tide of transgenic seeds. So I hope that you're as excited as I am to hear from Rose Edith, Flavio, and Bob.
To introduce myself also. I'm Steve Bartlett with Agricultural Missions and the U.S. Food Sovereignty Alliance, who are co-sponsoring this tour.
Soy Rose Edith Raymondville Germain.
So this is Rose Edith Raymondville Germain.
Soy Haitiana y Campesina.
She's a peasant farmer from Haiti.
Mi organización de base se llama MULAC, que quiere decir Movimiento para manos unidos para la liberación de la comunidad.
And her base community is called MULAC. It's the hands seeking for for strengthening the community.
Represento un movimiento nacional que se llama Movimiento Nacional del Congreso de Papaye.
The national movement she represents is called the National Peasant Movement of the Congress of Papaye.
Este movimiento tiene alrededor de 200,000 miembros.
This movement has approximately 200,000 members.
Represento también una plataforma que se llama Ojos con Ojos sin Mentira.
She's also part of a national platform called Eyes, Four Eyes Together Without Lies.
Y otra plataforma que se llama Fondama, que quiere decir Fundación Manos Unidos Haití.
And another alliance called Fondama, which is called Hands Together for Haiti.
Represento cuatro ojos que vienen de recibido, que ha recibido un premio de la Alianza para la Soberanía Alimentaria.
And the platform, the Four Eyes Together Against Lies, was part of, together with the Dessalines Brigade, just won the Food Sovereignty Prize that was awarded in New York City.
Y esas organizaciones hacen parte de la Vía Campesina, que es un movimiento mundial.
And these organizations are also part of Vía Campesina, which is a worldwide peasant movement.
Gracias. Estas organizaciones están luchando para un cambio social.
So these organizations are struggling for social change.
Voy a decir algo sobre Haití precisamente.
I'm going to present a few facts about Haiti first.
Haití está limitado en norte por la Oceano Atlantico. Atlantico.
Haiti is bordered in the north by the Atlantic Ocean.
Haiti está limitado al sur para por el mar del Caribe.
And in the south by the Caribbean Sea.
Al este por la República Dominicana.
And on the eastern border, the Dominican Republic.
Y por oeste está limitado por Cuba.
And of course, Cuba is there off the coast of the western coast.
Haiti tiene una superficie que es 27,750 kilómetros cuadrados.
Haiti has an area of 27,750 square kilometers.
Y tiene una población alrededor de 10 millones de personas.
And a population of approximately 10 million people.
La capital de este país, que es Puerto Príncipe, tiene alrededor de 13 millones de habitantes.
The capital of Haiti, Port-au-Prince, has approximately 3 million people.
El moneda de Haití se llama gulde.
And the money, our currency, is called the gourd.
Haiti tiene actualmente una cobertura vegetal de 3%.
Haiti only has a vegetative cover of about 3% of the land.
Y una cobertura de forestal de 2%.
And of that vegetative cover, only about 2% of the landmass is covered in trees.
Actualmente, Haití está viviendo de una crisis económico, político, social y ecológico.
Right now, Haiti is experiencing a social, economic, political, and cultural crisis.
Haiti es el país, es el segundo país que tiene más hambre y más pobre.
Haiti is the second most poor and most hungry country in the world.
Hay este país hay 78% de la población vive con menos de $2 por día.
78% of the Haitian people live on less income of less than $2 per day.
Y tiene 50% de la población que vive con menos de $1.
And about 50% of the population live with an income of less than $1 per day.
Aún hay 3% de la población que tiene 50% de las riquezas del país.
On the other hand, the 3% richest Haitians control more than 50% of all the income and wealth of the country.
Entonces, estamos viviendo de una situación muy mala.
So those show that we are in a very bad situation.
Después del terremoto que ha sucedido en Haití,
after the earthquake that took place in Haiti,
hay varias organizaciones que han venido allá.
Many organizations arrived in Haiti.
En la cual hay Monsanto,
including Monsanto Corporation.
Hay otros otras también.
And others also arrived there.
Han acaparado muchas tierras.
They have together taken over a lot of the lands of Haiti.
Tierras cultivables.
Land that could be used for food production.
Han acaparado estas tierras para hacer zona franca, para hacer plantación de jatropha.
They've taken this land to create industrial free trade zones and for export agriculture to produce agrofuels like jatropha.
Monsanto no es nuestro amigo.
Monsanto is not our friend.
No, no es.
It's not.
Monsanto está eliminando la semilla de las campesinas.
Monsanto is trying to eliminate the seeds that the farmers use.
Eso quiere decir que Monsanto es enemigos de los campesinos de las campesinas del mundo.
We could say that Monsanto is the enemy of all farmers in the world.
Porque quiere eliminar nuestra agricultura campesina.
Because they seek to eliminate our small-scale family farm type of agriculture.
Por eso estamos luchando muy fuerte contra Monsanto allá.
For that reason, we are fighting very hard against Monsanto.
Hemos realizado marcha contra Monsanto.
We have organized marches against Monsanto.
Hemos hecho una marcha que tenía 10 millones de personas.
We had a march that organized more than 10,000 peasants.
Otra marcha que realizamos tenía 15,000 personas contra el Monsanto.
Another march had 15,000 farmers marching against Monsanto.
Porque Monsanto es nuestro enemigo.
Because Monsanto is our enemy.
Y con la presencia de estas organizaciones, por ejemplo, el neoliberalismo.
With the presence of these organizations who are seeking a neoliberal policies.
Con sus presencias han violado muchas mujeres. Han violado muchas mujeres.
As a result of this entry of this agenda, many women have been raped.
Han violado niña que tiene un año al tres año.
Little girls have been raped as young as 1 to 3 years of age.
Han violado muchacho que tiene 14 años.
Little boys of 14 years of age have been raped.
Eso quiere decir ellos no son nuestros amigos.
So these are not our friends.
No son nuestros amigos. O las mujeres, las niñas. Sí. Mire, MINUSTA actualmente Haití está ocupando para la MINUSTA.
So Haiti is being occupied by a military force under the UN called MINUSTA.
El MINUSTA ha violado a muchacho de 14 años.
So that's what the rapes she was referring to, is the troops there.
El MINUSTA también no es nuestro amigo, aunque dice están allá para ayudarlo, pero no es verdad, es mentira.
So although MINUSTA is there supposedly to help us, it's false. They're not helping us.
Sus presencia aumenta la tasa de la natalidad prematura.
The presence of all these organizations, the occupying force, all these things has raised the infant mortality rate.
Aumenta el muerto nacio.
Has raised the number of children dying at birth.
Aumenta la discapacidad de los niños.
Has increased in the handicapping of children.
Esta situación han violado nuestro derecho, el derecho de los campesinos, de las campesinas.
So in all these ways, our rights as farmers have been violated.
Han violado nuestro derecho para comer una comida sana.
They've violated our right to eat healthy food.
Para cultivar con nuestras propias semillas.
To plant our crops with our own seeds.
Monsanto está distribuyendo semillas híbridas.
Monsanto is trying to distribute hybrid seeds.
Para destruir nuestra agricultura campesina.
Which would destroy our peasant agriculture.
Estamos luchando siempre contra ellos.
We are in a constant fight against them.
Monsanto es un azote, un mal. Que hasta devastación del mundo.
Monsanto is a great ill that's across the world. Yeah.
Tenemos que luchar con Monsanto.
We have to struggle against this attempt to control all the seeds.
Tenemos que luchar con el neoliberalismo.
We have to fight against the neoliberal policies.
Por eso hemos organizamos para hacer petición.
That's why we've organized ourselves to advocate, to do petitions.
Marchas.
To do marches.
Conferencia de prensa.
To have press conferences.
Y cabildeo.
To do lobbying.
Hemos hecho cabildeo a nivel local, nacional, hasta internacional.
And we've done this kind of advocacy at the local, national, and international levels.
Creo decir otra cosa, hasta hoy. Aunque decía el imperialista dice que han dado mucho dinero allá para la reconstrucción del país, hasta hoy mismo hay varias gente que está viviendo en la calle.
So although it's been claimed that so much money has gone to Haiti for the reconstruction since the earthquake, still we have so many people still homeless, still under tents.
Eso no es posible.
This we cannot allow.
En este sentido, estamos acá para compartir con los que quieren entender las informaciones, los que quieren saber cómo está la situación allá.
That's why we're here, to share with people who want to help what the true situation is in Haiti.
Tenemos que unirnos.
We need to unite ourselves.
Aunque somos lejos uno con otro, pero en base de informaciones podemos unirnos, comunicarnos para llegar.
Although we may live far away, we need to come together on a common understanding and struggle together against our common enemies.
Con esta situación, estamos reclamando reforma agraria.
So we're demanding agrarian reform.
Porque los campesinos no tienen tierra.
Because the farmers
trabajar.
Don't have enough land to work.
La tierra es para los que la trabaja.
We believe land should belong to those who work it.
Estamos reclamando un plan que conduce a la soberanía alimentaria.
We are struggling for a plan to achieve food sovereignty.
Y una legislación contra la violencia de las que hacía las mujeres.
So we are also trying to pass legislation to protect women against all kinds of violence.
Hemos pidiendo la integración de las mujeres, de las organizaciones de mujeres en todo lo que hacían.
And we want women to be fully participants in all levels of society.
Es así que estamos luchando.
That's how we are struggling.
Gracias.
Thank you.
Boa tarde.
Good afternoon.
Eu sou Flávio.
My name is Flávio.
Sou militante do MST de Brasil.
I'm an organizer with the Landless Movement in Brazil.
Que é esse movimento que luta pela terra em Brasil.
And it's this movement from the flag, and we struggle for land in Brazil.
E que desde 2009 estamos desenvolvendo uma ação de cooperação com os movimentos de Haiti.
Since 2009, we've been developing cooperative action with movements in Haiti.
Para desenvolver a solidariedade entre os movimentos.
And our goal is to try to develop solidarity between movements.
E promover o exercício do internacionalismo militante.
What we're trying to do with this is to promote the exercise of what we would like to call internationalism and militant internationalism.
Sou coordenador de la Brigada Dessalines.
I'm the coordinator of the Dessalines Brigade.
Dessalines é uma homenagem dada a dos negros, dos revolucionários da Revolução de Santo Domingo.
Dessalines, that's a name that we chose in order to honor one of the leaders of the Haitian Revolution, a revolutionary black leader.
Ele foi o primeiro presidente da República de Haiti.
He was the first president of the Republic of Haiti.
Esse povo que retirou las algemas da escravidão e ao mesmo tempo propôs la democracia e la solidariedade entre uma nação.
And we take this as a representative of a people who were able to throw off the chains of slavery and in the place to propose a plan for democracy.
Se olharmos a história, podemos nos perguntar, mas por que Haiti se encontra nessa situação de muitas fragilidades e de inseguridade alimentária?
Now, when we look at history, we might ask ourselves, after all of this, why is it that Haiti has found itself today in this situation of fragility and, in particular, of food insecurity?
Eis uma interrogação para nos fazermos e procurarmos uma resposta.
And that's a question that we need to ask ourselves, what's the answer?
La verdade está nas grandes potências do capitalismo.
And the truth, we will ultimately find, lies with the great powers of capitalism.
Que até hoje não permite esse povo ter sua soberania.
Who, until this very day, have not allowed this people to have its own sovereignty.
Que há imposto vários tratados, vários acordos, em que essa nação não tem condições de tornar-se soberana.
These powers have imposed treaties, agreements, that have not allowed this people to stand up as a sovereign people.
E quando, na maioria das vezes, lhes faltou o controle para essas potências, eles realizaram ações de sabotagem no país, financiando grupos, estimulando, entregando armas, drogas.
These organizations, when they have found that they begin to lose control in Haiti, have used sabotage. They finance armed groups, they send drugs, and they engage in acts that disrupt the stability of Haiti.
Um exemplo recente é da história mais recente de Haiti em 1990, na década de 80. O Haiti, não só Haiti, como todos os países da América Latina, década de 70, 80, passam por um processo de lutas por democracia, porque todos esses países estavam em plenas ditaduras civis e militares.
If we look at the recent history of the region, Haiti in the 1970s and 80s went through a process of struggle for democracy, very similar to the process that was being undertaken throughout Latin America as nations in Latin America tried to fight against the wave of dictatorships that controlled nearly the entire region.
Assim como em Brasil, em Argentina, em Uruguai, houve essas lutas pela democracia e em Haiti também. E nos anos 90, la transição democrática elege padre chamado Aristides.
It's a story that has connections with similar stories in Argentina, Brazil, Uruguay, throughout the region. A story about the struggle for democracy. And in the early 1990s, as a result of this process of struggle, the Haitian people elected a priest as president, Father Aristides.
Seis meses depois do governo de Aristide, o governo americano promove o sequestro do presidente Aristides.
Shortly after the election of Aristides, the United States government assisted in or encouraged the kidnapping of the president Aristides.
Somente esse exemplo para ilustrar, teríamos outros, por exemplo, como o de la ocupação americana que é feita em Haiti. De 1915 a
34. This gesture in the 1990s fits into a broader pattern. It's merely a single example. We can see this pattern repeating itself throughout history. For example, in the U.S. occupation of Haiti from 1915 to 1934.
Com a pretensa para o Estado americano de defender os seus interesses em uma dívida que havia recebido de la França. Dívida relacionada à revolução, dívida de guerra, injusta, por sinal.
What was the reason behind this U.S. occupation? It was precisely to defend the U.S. interests in a debt that ultimately can be traced back to the debt that Haiti had with France, a debt from a war, that is to say, a debt from independence, and by the way, a profoundly unjust debt.
30 mil militares marinheiros embarcaram em Haiti, afundaram toda a sua frota naval.
30,000 soldiers and sailors invaded Haiti. They sank the entire navy.
E saquearam todas as finanças do banco do Banco Nacional, da Casa de la Moeda.
They stole all of the resources in the National Bank and the National Mint.
E saquearam todas as artes, todos os monumentos, algo de valor histórico que tinha no país foram todos saqueados.
They took control of all of the arts and the monuments, anything that had historical value, they did not leave undisturbed.
O exemplo é em 1919, la Constituição de Haiti não é aprovada, eleita em Haiti, mas é no Congresso americano.
For example, in 1919, the Constitution of Haiti was not drafted or approved in Haiti. It was approved by the United States government.
E depois disso, até hoje, se tem em Haiti uma expressão de comunidade internacional.
Today, up to the present day, as a result of this process, Haiti is a place in which there is a profound concern with an expression of international solidarity.
Que é uma fala de principais embaixadas dos Estados Unidos, Canadá e França.
Haiti, in the center of Haiti, you can find embassies from the United States, from France, from Canada.
Sem contarmos o exemplo que a embaixada americana tem no Haiti, em média de 2,000 funcionários civis.
The U.S. Embassy in Haiti at this day has more than 200, it's more than 2,000 employees.
Sem contar em todo o aparato que tem outside.
Without even counting the full U.S. apparatus outside of the embassy.
É por isso que Haiti dizemos que não há soberania neste país hoje.
And it's for this reason that we can say Haiti is a country that today lacks sovereignty.
E uma das principais lutas do país é a sua autonomia nacional.
And as a result, one of the most important struggles in the country is for its national autonomy.
E retirar a interferência dos brancos sobre os processos democráticos.
And to remove the powerful influence of white people over democratic processes.
E los outros, las outras questões estão relacionadas à agricultura, como Rose Edith já abriu.
It's important to think of other questions too, questions related directly to agriculture, as Edith spoke of, as Edith mentioned.
Como vocês perceberam pelos números, Haiti é um país eminentemente agrícola.
As you may have noticed from her speech, Haiti is a country that's eminently agricultural.
Com técnicas muito rústicas, pouco desenvolvidas.
With rustic, old techniques that have not been developed along modern lines.
Os campesinos nas montanhas trabalham com machetes.
In the mountains, peasants work with machetes.
E muitos dos campesinos que trabalham nas regiões planas não têm uma enxada, uma para trabalhar a terra.
In the flat part of the country, in the plains, many of the peasant farmers who work don't have even a hoe to hoe the land.
E é por isso que é uma luta muito difícil e muito desigual que os movimentos têm.
For this reason, the struggle of peasant movements is a difficult one. It's a struggle that involves confronting a tremendous level of inequality.
Porque o governo atual, Martelly Lamotte, não tem um plano que de defesa da agricultura nacional.
The current government under Martelly Lamotte does not have a plan for the defense of national agriculture.
Toda a política que está se discutindo por agora é de levar o agrobusiness para Haiti.
The primary focus of all of the current discussions about agriculture is agribusiness, how to bring agribusiness into Haiti.
E para isso está estimulando plano de regularização de terras.
In order to facilitate this process, the government is currently promoting a plan to regularize the ownership of land.
Para as famílias camponesas que têm a partir de 15 hectares de terra.
This would work for peasant families that have more than 15 hectares of land.
Porque assim essas famílias com suas terras regularizadas poderão vender essas terras para as empresas capitalistas.
And why does this plan exist? So that these families who have 15 hectares of land can sell their land to capitalist firms.
Então é uma luta muito difícil que os movimentos começam a enfrentar agora.
So this is a serious struggle that movements are beginning to take up right now.
Porque já há vários experimentos de implantio de monocultivos de banana.
There are already a number of experiments, efforts to create monoculture plantation of bananas.
E há planos para implantação de monocultivos para agrocombustíveis.
And there are plans to produce large-scale monoculture of agrofuel or biofuel biofuel plant, to plant biofuels in a monocrop
então,
style.
Pensem na contradição que é um país que tem já uma grande pressão agrícola por alimentos.
And think of this, it's a profound irony. There's a country that has a tremendous pressure, tremendous demand for food items.
E agora vem o governo propondo essa política que pretende colocar tecnologias em grandes quantidades de terra.
And now a government is proposing to implement technologies that will involve taking over large quantities of land.
Poderá vir um processo em que aumentará mais ainda no êxodo rural para as vilas que já não suportam porque não há estrutura.
In order to promote a plan that's going to lead to a massive rural exodus, rural to urban migration that will only fill up slum communities in the cities that already lack a structure to accommodate their inhabitants.
Para ilustrar um pouco dos exemplos, Haiti em 2010 sofre uma grande tragédia.
We see a clear example of this, of the contradictions of the system in 2010,
todo
when
o mundo conhece que foi o terremoto de 12 de janeiro.
When Haiti suffered a tremendous tragedy, which we all know about, the earthquake of the 12th
no
of January.
No final da tarde, quando muitas das crianças estavam ainda na escola.
At the end of the afternoon, it happened when many children were still in school.
E que matou muitas famílias, muitas pessoas,
killed many families, many people.
E que deixou mais de 300 mil famílias desabrigadas.
Left more than 300,000 families without homes.
E que até hoje se tem mais de 250 mil famílias morando em barracas de lona.
To this very day, there are more than 250,000 families living in tents made out of canvas.
Que são assistidas por sopões, assim tratados como animais.
They're helped in the most minimal way, treated like animals.
E porque os recursos que têm entrado em Haiti não há plano estratégico para gerar o desenvolvimento.
For all the resources that have been brought into Haiti, there is no strategic plan for the development of Haiti.
O governo Martelly La Morte, durante período, utilizou-se desse problema catastrófico que era a vida das pessoas sem casa, sem moradia, para buscar ajuda internacional, para buscar dinheiro.
For a long time, the government of Martelly La Motte has used this problem, that is to say, the catastrophic lives of people who are finding themselves in terrible situations, in order to raise money internationally.
Tinha momento que o governo não se importava em as famílias estarem ocupando as praças com suas tendas, com suas barracas, mas teve outro período mais recente em que o governo trabalhou para dizer que o país estava melhorando.
For a time, the government was not concerned with people occupying central plazas or squares in the city with their tents or their improvised housing. But recently, the government has shifted. The government has begun to say that Haiti is improving and has taken a stand against these structures.
E adotou várias estratégias que legais e ilegais para retirar as famílias desses acampamentos.
The government has tried to shut down these encampments using several different strategies, some of them legal and others extra-legal.
As legais era de dar dinheiro, auxílio à moradia para que, não sei o valor, dólar americano, entre 400 e 500 dólares americano para que essa família deixasse a ocupação e retornassem para o seu interior.
So one of the most common legal apparatus was to give money to people, a so-called housing assistance. It was usually in the amount usually of $400 or $500 given to families in exchange for the family's departure from the city. Families must return to their homes in the interior of the country.
Os outros exemplos ilegais foram vários fatos na noite em que as famílias estavam em suas barracas e chegavam jagunços, muitos destes policiais e muitos articulados com o poder econômico desses acampamentos que estavam em regiões estratégicas e promoveram, colocaram fogo nas barracas, ameaçaram lá as famílias e fizeram com que as famílias destruíram todas as barracas e as famílias tinham que sair desses lugares.
This legal mechanism is accompanied by an illegal mechanism. We can describe this as the facts in the night. What are the facts in the night? And it's the arrival of bandits who are organized. Some of them are police officers. Others have direct links to economic power, to powerful economic actors. These facts in the night happen in particular in sites that are economically strategic, where it's important for economic actors to achieve control over the space. So the bandits arrive at night, they burn down people's houses, they destroy everything that they can, and they threaten the people who live there until the people leave.
Nesse contexto que nos encontramos na Via Campesina em Haiti, e uma das atividades que a Via Campesina promoveu foi organizar em uma das terras comunitárias e fazer uma experiência de agrovila com essas famílias desabrigadas e, a partir desse momento, trabalhar as experiências de agroecologia.
So it's inside of this context that Via Campesina has to work. For example, one of the activities that we organized was the following. We went to an area where people were camped out on collective land, and we organized an agrovilla. An agrovilla is a group of houses that are arranged to permit people to live together and work collectively on agricultural land. And on this land, inside the agrovilla, we organized families that were homeless to plant collectively and to be able to harvest. To plant in an organic or agroecological manner.
Dando pouco avançando aqui na discussão, vou falar algumas coisas do agrobusiness.
I'd like to move the discussion to talk a bit about agribusiness.
E a questão da fome no mundo.
And the way the connection between agribusiness and hunger in the world.
No discurso técnico de que através da tecnologia é possível matar a fome no mundo não é verdade.
There is a technical discourse, a discourse that says that it is technology that will allow us to kill hunger in the world. This is untrue.
O discurso desse setor utiliza uma contradição do próprio sistema capitalista e através do alimento, que é um bem sagrado ao ser humano, e trabalha a fundamentação técnica, procura desenvolver o convencimento na sociedade para desenvolver, aplicar os seus interesses, que é econômico, estritamente econômico.
This technological sector, this techno-business sector, uses a particular form of discourse, and what does this discourse involve? It starts with food, which is, for us, a sacred good, that is to say, a good that is sacred to humanity. And the discourse takes the sacred good and works it into a discourse about convenience, a discourse that allows the sacred good to be seen in the light of purely economic interests, interests that are understood only in economic terms.
A prática do agronegócio tem mostrado de que ele não produz alimentos para matar a fome do mundo.
The priority of agribusiness is a priority that we can see in the practice of agribusiness. Agribusiness is not oriented primarily towards producing food for people who are hungry in the world.
Se olharmos as estatísticas recentes, vamos ver que eles estão produzindo pensando em agrocombustíveis e grãos para animais.
If we look at the statistics provide a picture of agribusiness production, we can see two main priorities at the current historical moment. The first is agrofuels or biofuels, and the second is the production of animal feed.
E do pouco dos alimentos que produzem não tem qualidade, são contaminados por venenos.
The food that is produced by agribusiness is not high-quality food, and quite to the contrary, it's typically contaminated with agrotoxins.
Um exemplo de Brasil recentemente foi divulgada uma pesquisa científica em que na Universidade Federal de Mato Grosso, em que as mães que moram em uma região que há muito agrobusiness e muita utilização de veneno, é o leite materno que as crianças se amamentavam estavam contaminado já com veneno.
I'll cite an example from Brazil. There was a recent research study undertaken by the Federal University of Mato Grosso, which is one of the centers for the agribusiness production of soybeans. And this study examined the milk that mothers produce when they are nursing their children. It found high levels of agrotoxins in this milk among women who lived close to agribusiness production sites.
Tem estatística que demonstra também que 70% de todos os alimentos que nos alimentamos não é da grande propriedade, e sim das pequenas propriedades da agricultura campesina. De uma maneira em geral, nas estatísticas.
In a general way, we can see that 70% of the food that reaches the market and is used for consumption by people living domestically, 70% of this food does not come from large agribusinesses. It typically comes from smaller and medium-sized farmers.
É por isso que temos uma luta na via campesina, que é a defesa da soberania alimentar.
That's why in Via Campesina we're organized around a struggle for food solidarity.
Que vai muito além de termos o alimento em quantidade.
I'm sorry, food sovereignty.
Que vai muito além de termos o alimento em quantidade.
This means something much more, much deeper than simply having large quantities of food.
Mas também a discussão da qualidade, a forma como é produzido os alimentos e a relação do campesino com a nossa mãe terra.
Food sovereignty involves looking at two other questions beyond quantity. The first is, what is the manner in which food is produced? And the second is, what's the relationship that's established between the peasant and Mother Earth?
É por isso que em junho de 2010, pós-terremoto, a Monsanto fez presente ao Haiti, a agricultura, de 80 toneladas de milho híbridos e com sementes OGM, e nós, os campesinos, não permitimos isso e não plantamos essas sementes e colocamos fogo nas sementes que foram distribuídas.
In June of 2010, Monsanto gave a present. Monsanto offered 80 tons of hybrid hybrid corn seeds. These were genetically modified organism seeds that were given to Haiti. We didn't allow it. We didn't plant them. Not only that, but we took control of them and burned them.
É por isso que temos o desafio de trabalhar lá discussão da relação de los campesinos que produzem os alimentos e das pessoas que moram nas vilas, nas cidades, para consumir, fazer uma relação de elo para que haja um encontro entre os produtores com os consumidores.
There's a challenge that we were very concerned with and that we're working on right now. That challenge is how to work with the relationship between people who live in the countryside and people who live in poor neighborhoods in urban regions. This is the link of consumption. And our question is this: how is it possible for us to articulate a just and honorable link between these two groups of people?
E que a cidade passa a se preocupar com o campo e não meramente consumir o que vem do campo, mas passar a interrogar que produto está se alimentando, porque os exemplos têm demonstrado.
We want the city to start to worry about the countryside, to start to be concerned about the countryside. We want to break mere consumption, that is, the practice of simply eating something. We want people to think about what, to ask themselves the question, what is it that I'm eating and from where does it come?
Os índices de câncer, os índices de obesidades têm aumentado muito e a indústria da saúde tem ficado muito grata por isso.
the incidence of cancer, the incidence of obesity, both of these have increased dramatically, which has been a tremendous gift to the health industry.
precisamos debater isso para tomar consciência e passarmos a ter uma nova relação com a agricultura.
We need to think about this. We need to argue about it so that we can have a new consciousness and a new consciousness that can be the base for a new agriculture.
E a resposta está nos produtos da agricultura camponesa.
And the answer, the outcome of this discussion, is in the very products themselves, the products of peasant agriculture.
E precisamos apoiar essas iniciativas com a agricultura agroecológica, com o uso da técnica, não pensando no aspecto de equivalência monetária, mas pensando nessa relação de que somos parte da Mãe Terra.
So, in order for this to happen, we need to support agroecological or organic techniques. These are techniques that lead us not towards a monetary equivalence. Monetary equivalence is not the basis for the system. What is the basis for the system is a relationship with our Mother Earth.
Nós, os campesinos, estamos trabalhando permanentemente esse desafio e esperamos que vocês na cidade façam o mesmo.
We, the peasants, are working constantly around this challenge, and we hope that you in the city will join us.
E marcarmos encontro no caminho para prosseguir essa relação.
And that's why we need to set a date to meet each other on the road and keep
Thank
moving
you.
Forward.
So we're open for questions. Oh, well, Bob has a brief presentation, and then we can have a common dialogue.
No, we'll talk about it later. Hi, everyone. Good afternoon. I will be brief because I want to make sure we have plenty of time for y'all to ask these incredible folks your questions. So I'm a farmer and a farm worker from Maine, and if you're wondering what the connection here is. Well, I'm involved in Via Campesina through an organization called Family Farm Defenders. We are a member of National Family Farm Coalition, which is one of four members of Via Campesina North America. I consider myself to be a peasant farmer. I primarily subsistence production with my family. And, you know, Maine, just give you a couple statistics here. You know, Maine, 150 years ago, was not only were we self-sufficient in food, but we exported food to major markets in the Northeast, in Boston and Hartford and New York City. Today we import about 93% of our food. We essentially export raw materials and we import everything else that we need. We have one of the highest rates of federal disbursements for disability, for Medicare, for food stamps, SNAP. We have been transformed from a productive, self-sufficient people into a dependent people who honestly can't survive economically without federal dollars. This has happened through very systematic transition. I look at what has happened in this country over the last 70, 80 years as essentially the proving ground for what's happening all over the world. You know, we have endured the dumping that we talk about happening from the U.S. externally, but Maine's been dumped on for a very, very long time. We have, because of the increase in poverty and the lack of, the loss of our production capacity as rural people, we've endured internal displacement. My family is scattered all over the country. And so we essentially, at this point in our history here in the United States, it's kind of an end game scenario for corporate agriculture. You know, they have tested their technologies and their ability to manipulate markets and policy, and they are at a point where we will be without the means to fight back. Over the next 20 years in this country, 400 million acres of land is going to transfer hands because of our aging farming population and the fact that we've not been able to train and keep the next generation because a lot of us have left for the city. So if we are not preparing now, both in terms of our community's ability to feed themselves, but also the ability of us to access that land on a secure basis, then what will become of those lands? They'll continue to be corporate agriculture, producing the corn and soy that you see around your city. And that will just further strengthen the corporate agricultural model that enriches them at the expense of all of us. So there's a corn farmer from Iowa by the name of Brad Wilson, and he's estimated that since the 1950s, rural America has lost $3 trillion. That money has ended up in the pockets of corporate agriculture, and they have used that to spread their tentacles around the country. And so we need to develop a resistance movement here in this country. We need people moving back to the land. You know, we need our communities to feed themselves again. We can't do this without a rural-urban connection, because those of us in the countryside essentially are too poor to do it ourselves. Last Friday, myself and an author named Raj Patel published an article on Civil Eats called This Land is Our Land, and it's an attempt to raise the question of land reform in this country. And I encourage you to check that out, because one of the points we make, or one of the solutions we propose, is that a way of dealing with the catastrophic student loan debt that I'm sure some of you are enduring, and I'm certainly enduring, is to have the ability to use that loan payment to pay for land. So essentially, it's a way that if you graduate college and you have a load of debt and you want to do something that doesn't reward you economically, like farming or food production, that you'd have an opportunity to do that, and you won't be essentially trapped in this debt cycle. So I encourage you to check that out, and please share it, and let's have a discussion about how we in the United States can take back our sovereignty and feed ourselves again. Thanks.
Thank you, Bob. We're open to questions, comments, and maybe have a dialogue. Maybe even talk about ways we might connect and work together on some of the things we're doing, and some of the things you might be doing.
I have one question. First of all, I want to thank everyone for coming here to speak to us, and also for the very important work that you're doing in your homes. And listening to all three presenters, one thing that really stood out to me was this, the following. That food vulnerability, historically speaking, and in the present, is often connected to international food markets. So I think of the great Irish famine, when grain was leaving the port of Dublin, going to London, while the countryside starved. And I think of the great South Indian famine of 1877, when food was leaving India, going to Great Britain, while the countryside starved. And now hearing stories from Haiti of biofuels going to metropolitan centers, while the countryside is put in dire straits. Or even of Maine, where food exports are on the rise while food vulnerability increases at home. And I think thinking of these commonalities, it really shows how these problems demand both local responses but also international responses. And so I think it's so important that you all are working at once at your homes but also working together. But I'm curious about the different ways in which you address officials in your homes, but also representatives of corporations, of governments, of international organizations, in your advocacy transnationally, internationally, in solidarity.
¿Cómo inciden con las multinacionales, con los oficiales, con los que toman decisiones? ¿Cómo presionan, cómo relacionan con estas entidades, estos poderes o representantes de poderes?
And so that's the question, how one addresses sort of local officials, local stakeholders, but also the international figures who are also important.
Podemos dizer que a nível internacional
Estamos numa luta de classe contra as multinacionais do agrobusiness.
We could say that we're in a struggle internationally as a class against transnational corporations.
As multinacionais procuram avançar sobre as propriedades dos campesinos, por exemplo, as sementes.
The transnationals are trying to take away the assets, the goods that peasants have, such as seeds.
Propriedade não no sentido de valor monetário, mas no sentido de valor imaterial para as famílias campesinas.
So these assets are not, you know, we don't consider them to have a monetary value. They are the basic goods that the people have.
Tem vários exemplos de, por exemplo, como a Monsanto, em Índia, procura fazer articulações com governos.
We have examples, for example, how Monsanto relates to the government of India.
Para aprovar planos de liberação e comercialização de sementes transgênicas.
To approve plans and legislation for the free liberation of GMOs into the Indian countryside.
Em Brasil tem o mesmo exemplo.
In Brazil we have a similar example.
Na semana passada, com todas as lutas que foram feitas em torno do Dia Mundial da Alimentação.
Last week, in all the actions taken around the World Food Day, which is October 16th.
A Via Campesina Brasil promoveu vários protestos, incluindo ocupações no Ministério da Agricultura.
The Via Campesina Brazil organized several protests, including one at the Ministry of Agriculture.
E uma das coisas que conquistamos foi barrar num projeto de comercialização dos transgênicos.
And one of the things we stopped or are trying to stop is the commercialization of GMO seeds.
Porque uma das coisas que eles não querem é que haja a identificação que o produto é transgênico nos supermercados.
What they don't want is labeling of products in the market saying that they are GMO products.
E outro exemplo mais maldoso de Monsanto é em Brasil em relação à soja transgênica.
Another example is regards GMO soybeans in Brazil.
A soja transgênica entrou em Brasil pela ilegalidade.
GMO soybeans were illegal in Brazil.
Através de um contrabando que foi feito entre Argentina e Uruguai.
But because of contraband GMO soy coming in from Argentina and Uruguay.
Eles entregaram as sementes aos campesinos.
They delivered these seeds and gave them to farmers.
E depois que tinha a produção de soja nos armazéns, os camponeses, de uma forma geral, não podia comercializar.
And after the farmers produced all these genetically modified soybeans, they couldn't sell them.
Porque não havia legislação para isso.
Because it wasn't legal to do so.
E para isso eles começaram a organizar o movimento social dos produtores que queriam comercializar sua soja.
So a social movement rose up among these farmers wanting to legalize the selling of GMOs.
E passaram a fazer pressão no parlamento para que aprovassem o comércio desse produto.
And they pressured the government to legalize the sale of GMO soybean in Brazil.
Foi assim que foi regularizada a soja em Brasil.
That's how GMO soy became legalized in Brazil.
O outro exemplo é de la dependência que muitos campesinos, pequenos camponeses que nessas regiões onde foram plantado las sojas transgênicas, foram contaminadas suas sojas crioulas.
Also, a lot of the small producers in the area where this GMO soybean came in, their beans got gradually contaminated by the genetic material.
E as sementes crioulas dos camponeses foram contaminadas pelas sementes transgênicas.
And their own native seeds got contaminated by those genetics.
E na hora que esses produtores vão comercializar os produtos nos portos, é feita uma análise do produto e contém transgênico.
So when these products go to be exported or sold, they are tested and then, these farmers who say they have conventional seeds, they have genetically modified seeds.
E assim, por cada saca, os campesinos têm que pagar 80 centavos de dólar para poder comercializar de direitos para a Monsanto, mesmo que eles não tenham pegado a semente de Monsanto.
So even if they did never bought Monsanto seeds or went into any kind of contract with Monsanto, they are now required to pay 80 cents on the dollar in royalties for that contamination, because of that contamination.
Até hoje tem várias ações judiciais nos tribunais em Brasil dos campesinos protestando contra esse imposto.
So there's many protests in Brazil have taken place protesting this requirement that they pay royalties to Monsanto.
Porque eles não pegaram as sementes, eles foram usados, manipulados.
So they never bought Monsanto seeds, they were the victims of this genetic drift.
Mas a Monsanto diz que ele está utilizando a sua semente e de propriedade ela tem direito ao royalties.
And Monsanto is accusing them of having stolen their genes and saying they must pay for it.
Lá a estratégia de nossos movimentos da Via Campesina,
the Via Campesina strategies,
é atuar nos diferentes fóruns internacionais,
to act in different international forums,
defendendo a soberania alimentar,
defending food sovereignty,
a produção dos alimentos saudáveis,
the production of healthy foods,
as sementes como patrimônio dos povos a serviço da humanidade.
The non-privatization, or that's looking at seeds as something that should never be patented, that should be considered the common and heritage of all humanity.
Exemplo é que durante todos os anos 2000 houveram vários enfrentamentos internacionais, principalmente contra a OMC.
So over the course of the past 20 years, there have been various mass mobilizations at international spaces, principally against the World Trade Organization.
E a OMC hoje em dia é uma instituição que pouco tem credibilidade no mundo.
Resulting that today the World Trade Organization has little credibility in the world.
Em parte tem a ver com toda essa luta que os movimentos têm feito contra essa forma, essa proposta de comércio desigual entre as nações.
Because of the actions of people protesting against this unfair, unequal form of trade that the World Trade Organization is promoting.
O exemplo de maldade como o que ocorre nos Estados Unidos em sua relação com o México.
One example is the relationship of trade between the US and Mexico.
Que o governo americano subsidia a produção de milho.
For example, the US subsidizes corn production here in the United States.
E esse milho é vendido ao México a preço muito barato.
That corn is sold in Mexico for a very low price, below the cost of production.
E com isso acaba quebrando os campesinos de México.
That's how we broke the market and bankrupted so many Mexican corn farmers.
E eles perdem suas terras e acabam vindo para migrar para os Estados
they
Unidos.
Lose their lands, they end up having to migrate to cities or to the United States.
São planos irracionais que não há sentido de cooperação entre os países.
These are irrational policies that don't have no sense of international cooperation.
Mas uma ganância por parte das empresas, das corporações que hoje têm se apropriado da política democrática, assim dizendo.
It's about the profit taking of these corporations that have now had so much influence using money to control the political process also.
E por isso que uma das nossas lutas é pela democracia.
So our struggle is also about democracy, regaining democracy.
Porque percebemos que a democracia hoje ela está sequestrada pelo poder econômico.
We consider that democracy has been kidnapped by economic elites.
Um exemplo claro disso é nos processos eleitorais.
And have influenced the electoral processes.
Em que as empresas têm liberdade para financiar campanhas.
Where corporations have greater and greater freedom to finance political campaigns.
E pensem como será candidato que receberá dinheiro privado, qual será o seu compromisso depois de eleito.
So when a politician receives private money for his campaign, who do you think they will respond to when he gets into power?
É isso que acontece em Brasil, em Haiti, por exemplo, em vários países do mundo.
This happens in many countries in Brazil and Haiti.
O sequestro da política pelo poder econômico.
The complete kidnapping of the state, the government by these private interests.
Por isso que uma das propostas é que as campanhas políticas tenham um controle público sobre ela.
So we are also pushing for public control of campaigns. You know.
E que haja transparência nos processos.
There must be transparency in political campaigns. You know.
Porque uma empresa que dá dinheiro para financiar a campanha, ela tem os seus interesses a ser preservado.
A corporation that finances political candidates in that way preserves their own interests.
Ela não está dando dinheiro porque ama a democracia liberal, porque é bom ver as pessoas indo votar, fazendo as filas, participando.
They're not financing it because they think this is a good way to encourage democracy, the development of democracy, and the democratic process.
As empresas fazem isso porque elas sabem que elas têm barreiras que protegem a sociedade, e elas precisam derrubar essas barreiras, e a única forma é ter políticos que estejam reféns às suas propostas.
These corporations finance politicians to create walls that protect them from the majority of us.
E na democracia ainda, para concluir, devemos avançar na exigência de participação direta do poder da sociedade, na sociedade.
So we must push for redemocratization, where everyone is participating in the democratic process.
Como referendos com propostas de lei em que a maioria da população propõe e o parlamento é obrigado a referendar.
So for example, a method where the majority of the people can make proposals to the government and the government must put them up for referendum, popular referendum.
Isso é um passo que podemos dar para o acúmulo da nossa luta.
This is a step that we could take for our struggles.
Isso.
Okay. In Maine, we've been using local ordinances through our town meeting process, which is really the tradition of people gathering in towns and having basically it's direct democracy.
Direct democracy in action. And so over the last 10 years, towns have passed local ordinances prohibiting extraction of groundwater by Nestle. We put moratorium on production of GMOs within the town limits. And most recently, we've been passing local food ordinances that exempt direct transactions from state and federal license and inspection requirements, because we know that one of our greatest challenges as small farmers and producers is the regulatory apparatus that skews everything towards larger scale business and essentially criminalizes us and squeezes us out. So we've essentially gone after taking control of our power where it exists. And the town meeting, when we pass these ordinances, it then puts the state or even the corporations on the defensive. Like, if you want to, we're going to do this here, and if you don't want us to, you're going to have to come after us. So that's kind of the strategy.
I was wondering, because it seems like they're using two unfortunate events to control, to coordinate taking over. Mm-hmm. Do they do those in other countries?
Yeah. Are you referring to the earthquake 1 month after that earthquake?
Yeah.
Yeah. Parece que Monsanto está usando catástrofe para hacer entrar, para tomar oportunidad, para entrar sus semillas en Haití. Está haciendo eso en otros países también, llegando en el momento de crisis para poner sus semillas. Fue un comentario. La pregunta es si están haciendo otros ejemplos en otros países.
El principal es la apropiación de la política.
Creo que el Monsanto no está jugando solamente en Haití. Es casi en todos los países han atacado los campesinos. Es por eso he dicho ahorita que estamos unimos, estamos hablando e estamos haciendo cambio entre nosotros, los campesinos, porque este plan no solamente para los haitianos, para Haití, pero es para los campesinos, campesinos del mundo.
So, yeah, what you said is so true, and that's why we're here. It's one of the reasons why we're here, because Monsanto is doing this all over in many countries. It might not be an earthquake. It might be some other opportunity they're taking to get their seeds into the other countries. And so that's why we need to unite ourselves with other peasants all around the world so that we can have a common struggle against them, since they're everywhere, so many countries. Very good question.
There was a book written about this subject by a woman named Naomi Klein.
Shark Doctrine.
Yes, Naomi Klein.
Yeah, I just again wanted to thank you all for coming here and sharing with us. I was a little late, so you might have mentioned this earlier, but could you just speak a little bit to the, if you haven't spoken to it already, what some of the specific responses were, or sort of what happened after the organizations in Haiti and the Central Plateau collected the seeds from Monsanto and burned them? Were there any political ramifications? What were some of the steps afterwards? And kind of where does it leave you all right now?
Después de que quemaron las semillas de Monsanto, ¿cuáles han sido las consecuencias o resultados para los movimientos campesinos en Haití sobre Monsanto y sus semillas? ¿Cuál es la situación política y después sobre las semillas de Monsanto? ¿Cuáles fueron los resultados de esto?
Em 2010 houve uma ocasião especial em Haiti.
2010 was a very special moment in Haiti.
Com o terremoto, muitas das pessoas de imediato procuraram refúgio na casa de seus familiares no interior.
Just to give a little context, you know, the people who fled the earthquake zone went out to the country and they had to be fed. And so the farmers used up all their seed to feed them.
E com isso, as famílias acabaram consumindo suas sementes de plantio.
So a lot of families used up all their seed corn to plant the next crop, feeding the refugees from the earthquake.
E por isso que também houve esse presente de Monsanto.
And that's another reason why Monsanto thought it was an opportune time to come in. They don't have any seeds to plant. Let's bring in seeds.
Com a reação dos campesinos de protesto de não aceitar as sementes de Monsanto.
Because the campesinos protested and burned the seeds and said, we're not going to plant these seeds.
Uma das ações que realizamos foi através da Via Campesina.
One of the actions we did was through Via Campesina.
Foram trazidas de Brasil grandes quantidades de milho crioulo.
We brought a lot of Creole or native varieties of corn from Brazil.
E que foram distribuídos em Haiti.
Which were distributed to the farmers in Haiti.
O que sabemos é que os campesinos realmente não plantaram as sementes de Monsanto.
What we do know is we don't know of any peasants who planted Monsanto seeds.
Os primeiros que haviam recebido essas sementes foram realizados reuniões em suas comunidades e foram colocadas fogo nessas sementes.
A lot of groups who had received Monsanto seed, you could tell it apart because it had a pink fungicide on it. These farmers gathered together and they had public meetings about it, and many of them burned them in different locations, not just in the big march.
O restante das sementes não sabemos o que foi feito. Sabemos que estavam estocadas nos armazéns do Ministério da Agricultura. Não sabemos se elas regressaram para as mãos de Monsanto.
We don't know what actually happened to the seeds. We knew they were being stored in the Ministry of Agriculture of Haiti, but we don't know what happened to them, whether they got sent back to the United States or where they are. I could also mention that some organizations in solidarity with the peasant movements gathered money. We gathered resources because a lot of people wanted to help the Haitian people. And I think $2.5 million went down, and the coalitions of farmers met and decided how the seeds would be, because there were a lot of seeds in Haiti in storehouses, native seeds, just to provide money. So, for example, family that received refugees each got 20 pounds of beans, 6 pounds of corn. They got machetes. They got extra hoes. They got peanuts. They got rice, depending upon what the crops are that they grow. The youth got several pounds of vegetable seeds at a youth assembly, and this was distributed all across Haiti so those families could produce and have a next crop, and then from that crop, they returned the same amount of seeds they returned them to a community seed banks. So at the same time, people were being trained to create seed silos to hold in community the seeds that they needed to plant the next year, because they said, we can't let that happen, what happened to us. We have to have our own supply of seeds to replant. So community seed banks were established in many, many communities, and about 120 people were trained to build these metallic silos to store the seeds. So there was a lot of work that countered the effort of Monsanto to put their boot on the people's neck, you know. Tenemos tiempo para una pregunta más. One more question, yes.
As a beginning farmer, I'm new to farming.
Yes,
So I'm trying to obtain my own land. Right now I'm just a backyard farmer. And so what I've been doing is, because I've gotten into it, mainly because I had learned about GMOs, my children's health, they had allergies, and finding out that you're reading labels, not everything is on the product. Yes, and needing to feed them, you know, whole foods. So I guess what I want to ask is, how do we start a movement on the grass level roots? I mean, I've been talking to people about it, but it's not really, I guess, hitting home for them. So how do we grow this movement so that people in the United States will want to participate?
Have you been out to Black Oaks, Pembroke?
Yes, I know them.
Okay. All right. We were there yesterday, and I'd say that's probably the place to have that conversation, because that's the conversation we had out the door, was how do we get the people in all our different diverse communities who are doing this together so that we can form collective power. And I think that's really ultimately what it is. It's organizing small groups of people, the MST in Haiti, they were talking about organizing in 10 to groups of 15 to 20. You know, and I think that's a really good model. It's something that's working for us in Maine, communities of people coming together to help each other succeed on the land, but also to do economic things together, like creating shared use kitchens, infrastructure that we can share, those sorts of things. You know, so we're essentially rebuilding all the stuff that we lost, and that's, we need people to do that. So I think in your case, continuing the conversation with the folks out at Black Oaks would really be helpful, I think.
There's also growing power that can let students have food production here. And I think there are probably many other community organizations
with community gardens and things. One thing we've done in Louisville is there's been a really good organizing effort in communities that have problems of access to food, like healthy food, like in your case. And that's been to meet with people over the winter, have talks about why it is that good food is not available in your communities, and have people tell their own food stories, and then organize, these people then can organize among themselves to collect their money, they say, to buy food from a farmer, contact local farmers to provide food for that community that they can bring in and just drop off, and the community can distribute it among themselves. There's a way of doing like a one-week CSA model, where you pay a week in advance, and some of the shares are subsidized, $12 for a good basket of food, or $25. And the farmer, it helps them out, because they can bring food and get a pretty good price for it by delivering it wholesale to the community. Just need a bunch of people, maybe 5 or 6 or 7 leaders in the community, can help organize these points where the food can be distributed. in the food. And then you visit the farm, and then pretty soon you're interested in working a little on the farm, and then from there you develop more and more interest in the food economy. You know.
Yeah, because that's basically what I want to do. I want to partner with people like with Black Oaks and attempt to grow these, what we're called, what they call food hubs, you know, along the Black Belt, that's what we're calling that little section, but to, I guess, join with other organizations. For me, it's kind of like local or regional, but I'm trying to see how do we, you know, stretch out further. So how they're coming here and speaking to us, how can we go and share our stories as well?
Right. So I'm happy to provide my information, and we can connect people. I can help interpret or send messages in other languages if you want to connect with the people here. And there's the U.S. Food Sovereignty Alliance that's bringing together people across the United States, and we're working on some policy issues. We're going to try to work on seeds, actually producing our own seeds. You know, you might be able to produce a seed of some valuable vegetable, and that is worth a lot more than the actual food, and you could then put it in packets and sell it to other gardens and stuff like that. So we're talking about these different things, and we need all people like yourself to be a part of it. If we can connect with you in some way, and if you have a little spare time from time to time to send a message or hear from us, we can connect our efforts, and then you'll hear about things like we might have a trip down to Haiti to see what they're doing, because they're feeding a lot of people with small-scale agriculture, stuff like that. So we'd love to share our contact information. Well, I guess the time's done. Well, thank you so much for your attention.